Today I am expected to speak about the basics of spiritual astrology. Aquarian age has opened many new horizons of astrological science, and the speed of the Aquarian age is such that we see packets after packets of books on astrology dumped in the market. Necessarily, some of them wonderful and some of them just for business. But every attempt, when it is fresh and novel, is bound to have good and bad put together. So we have, broadly speaking, three divisions of the astrological literature. One is what we call the popular astrological books, which are more colorful in their pictures and diagrams, and which are ready to attract the bibliomaniac in the market. Another group of astrological books is those books which stood the test of time for about a century or more. By such books I mean the works of great authors like Alan Leo, Sepharial, Max Hindale and their followers. These books contain the astrological tradition of various nations which stood the test of dozens of years. They contain not only astrology for soothsaying, what we call fortune telling, but something deeper. When you go deeper into any subject, you will find yourself gradually. By that I mean the human values that are not changed through time. So these standard works on astrology, they contain the valuable material about you, which is of real use to yourself. And when we go still further, we have a third group of astrological books, that is the original books of those authors who have presented us the signs centuries ago. It is a wonderful thing that these books contain still something which is new to mankind, for the simple fact that they contain something very old. Just as your appetite is every day new to your taste and food, simply because your appetite belongs to your age from your beginning, you cannot say that the appetite grows old. Every time you want something to eat, you find that your appetite is once again new, better than the previous appetite. This is the case with the healthy constitution. Similarly, it is the case with the healthy mind which seeks for the secrets of science. If you go into the scriptures like the Old Testament or the Vedas or the Puranas or the ancient Buddhistic tantric texts, you find something very deep and very significant of human values, at the same time carrying much about what we call astrology. Though sometimes the Christian church classed astrology as the work of the devil, every page in the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, proves that it is a divine science, a gift given by God to make our eyes open to hidden secrets, secrets of yourself. It gives the true keys for you to go into your own mind and your own way of understanding things. What awaits you in this creation? What is expected of you to the humanity around you? And how to do it properly? And how not to do anything. That is, we can know the wrong ways of our doing things. we can rectify ourselves from our own wrong ways. We can know the right way of our doing things and follow that which is desired. One misconception about astrology, which makes us unfit to use astrology though we study it, is a belief in fatalism. There are some who believe that life is predestined. It is not so true. There are some who believe that life is the result of one's own free actions and decisions. So, on one side we have the fatalist who believes that everything is already written there about his future and he has nothing to do. On the other side, we find the blind rationalist who believes that he creates his own future every moment. Each of these two people have only one eye to see. They have grown blind of the other eye because there is 50% truth in what each of these fellows believe. And just as the passenger traveling in a big ship has his own free will to go around the ship on the deck anywhere and to spend his time in the ship in whichever manner he likes, the one who is living on this is having freedom of action and speech and behavior. But at the same time, the passenger cannot jump out of the ship. Though he is walking on the deck of the ship on four directions, he is traveling only in the direction in which the ship is traveling. Similarly, we are all there on this earth globe. We can go to any country or any town or any city or any village. We can eat or stop. We can sleep or stop. We can read whatever book we want. But yet, we are being led by this earth only in the direction in which the earth is going. So, in the individual sense and the personal sense, we are curtailed of our freedom. But in the sense of our will, which is called the creative consciousness, which is called buddhi in the scriptures, and in the sense of our soul consciousness, we are completely free to decide the nature and the taste of our future. See how two people on the ship behave in two different manners. The one enjoys the sunrise and the sunset in the sea when he is traveling in the ship, whereas the other sleeps in his own death night and day until he completes the journey. The first one is having a very colorful and delightful journey, whereas the second one is having a drowsy, sleepy and infernal type of journey. So we are free to choose the either. We have the absolute freedom to choose the one way or the other. We do not feel the existence of this freedom until we cross the levels of our individual consciousness and personality. As individuals, we are prisoners. Prisoners in the cell of our own physical body, conditioned by our own likes and dislikes, and playthings in the hands of our own emotions and tastes, and we cannot go out of our own tastes and our own chains of behavior. For example, we cannot like what we dislike. So we have to live as dogs in the hands of our likes and dislikes. This is one layer of existence which is called individuality, which is very, very valuable in the eyes of some people. Many of us feel I should not lose my individuality. But after traveling through some steps of evolution, we understand that there is the next expansion of consciousness, which we call personality. Then we come to understand that others also have appetites just as we are having. others also are having likes and dislikes just as we are having, and that others also have a right to live just as we have a right to live. Then for the first time we begin to give and take at the same time. So we make a trade and commerce of our good behavior. We work something useful for the world and get something by way of remuneration for ourselves to live. We can call it a trade of our virtues. That is when we begin to practice virtues. Even in that stage we are prisoners. Not prisoners of our appetites, but prisoners of our fears and complexes. We fear we may lose our job. We may fear that we may lose our money. We fear we may be punished. Like that we are dogs in the hands of complexes. So we are still prisoners. Not in the narrow room of our body, but in a bigger hall like this. We have some space to move, but still we are kept under locks and key. And then we begin to feel the existence of our own higher consciousness, which we call will. Many of us really do not know the real meaning of the word will. I am suffering from some disease due to the disparity of climate in Geneva. And if I cannot be cured by the doctors, and if everyone advises me to change the place to another country, it may not be possible for me, because I am living in one of these two levels. Then I begin to feel I have my property and house, everything here, and my own relatives and friends are killed here. I have many social and domestic relationships around here. I am a native of this land. How can I leave this country and go as the native of another country and live as a foreigner in some other country? This is how we are imprisoned in these two levels. But suppose after suffering for about 10 years or 12 years with the horrible disease like asthma, I make a fair trial by just going for a month to Los Angeles and find everything wonderful, and I suddenly decide to change my native land, find my rest of life really healthy. What made me decide to go away, and what was it that didn't allow me to decide for 12 years? The difference is what the wise people call will. Will is not intelligence. Will is not the obstinacy to resist the views of others. Will is not the animal tendency to oppose others and criticize others or to disobey others to prove that we are independent. But it is something very sweet and at the same time creative, whereas our intelligence is not at all creative. What we call intelligence is only a routine activity of the machine of mind. It is part of our behavior or habit. We are intelligent because of our habit, not because of our originality. But we take sometimes good decisions not out of habit, but breaking a habit. If we break a habit for something worse, once again it forms part of our lower self. But whenever we are capable of taking a decision which is better for us and others, then we begin to enter into a new horizon which is called the will by the great ones. The will is creative and it creates life that is new. Whereas intelligence is routine which allows us to live and eat and earn and die. इंटेलिजेंस इज इनफ ओनली फॉर अस टू नो हाउ टू अर्न एंड हाउ टू लिव बट इंटेलिजेंस नेवर परमिट्स अस टू नो व्हाई वी अर्न एंड हाउ वी शुड स्पेंड सो इट बिलोंग्स टू द मैकेनिकल एक्टिविटी ऑफ आवर इंस्ट्रूमेंट सो सम फाइन मॉर्निंग वी एंटर इन टू द थर्ड होराइजन वी बिगिन टू डू थिंग्स इंस्टेड ऑफ ट्राइंग टू डू थिंग्स Previously, we tried to do good things. We were reading and reading the books of great people and admiring the wonderful points written there. And we have great ideals to achieve. That means we are not ready to achieve. So we live in the two levels. And then the ideals cease to be ideals when we enter into the plane of the will. Because they enter into your practical life and they cease to be ideals. When you once enter into the life of will, you will never think of doing some good things, but you begin to do it. And you never think how you do it, and you never think of the consequences. Because something is very sure about your actions. You will create a future for yourself, which is the result of your own behavior. And then there is another plane which we are expected to enter. This plane somehow is very, very subtle. It is not difficult to enter into that plane, but we always slip out and miss the plane. It is too smooth to permit us to step in. It is what the wise ones call the plane of love. The plane where you feel happy in giving, in doing something, in spending time for the humanity. Gradually you will stop thinking about the remunerative aspect of it. Because you will discover a great truth. You are living not due to the remuneration of your work, but you are living because you are to live, and that your work is making you live. That is called the soul consciousness, which gives us the taste of real life. Then we begin to exist to ourselves. Previously, we existed to our appetites, and we never existed to ourselves. We existed to our habits and our indulgence. We had no time at all to exist to ourselves. We were very busy with the taste of our food and drink, and too busy with our sleep and our sex and our work. So we were busy, very, very busy in tasting something which is different from ourselves. So we had no time to live as ourselves. Then in the second plane, also we had no time to live as ourselves. Because we were busy in living as our own fears and complexes. If you call and say, hello, Krishnamacharya, you will find anger, Mr. Anger instead of Mr. Krishnamacharya in the face. Next day, if you call him, you will find fear, Mr. Fear instead of Mr. Krishnamacharya. Like that, we lived as fears, anxieties, depressions, complexes. So when our plan is living, we have no place to live in us. We are occupied with our own ideas. We were not at our own ideas. And we were packed, filled with something valuable and which was not ourselves. And so we had no place or time to live as ourselves. And then we began to find some time to live as ourselves in the third plane. We had the power and time to leave the place when we had to change the native place. And when I purchased a bad article and I was deceived, paid a great price for a spoiled article, I had the power to throw it away and purchase a new one for my use. Instead of spending not only money but also some time also foolishly for this spoiled earth. So we have some time to live as ourselves. And then we found ourselves established. This is the training which the devas and the intelligences of nature intend to give us. And what we call the planets are only ashrams, are the abodes of some groups of devas. When we study astrology from the esoteric and the spiritual point of view, but when we study astrology for curiosity or to find out what the author's opinion is about our birth, we don't find anything except our own foolishness in the pages. As long as we are searching for the opinions of the astrological authors about our own behavior, for example, Krishnamacharya discovers that he is born under the sign Leo and tries to find out in a market astrology textbook, which is called the Sun Sign Astrology, he just turns all the pages without looking into them, because he is concerned only with the pages on Leo, and the author has given his own impressions about Leo, which are often correct, but about me they are not correct often, because he has written about Leo, not about Krishnamacharya. So this is the fate of the curiosity mongers who search astrological textbooks for their future. They are often disappointed because predictions go wrong. This is because life is not written in any book. What we call Leo is only one room in the great ship of the zodiac. There are 12 big divisions on this big ship, and I was asked to enter into the big division called Leo and asked to occupy one particular room in Leo until the journey is finished. What's the use of me, my believing that Leo room is mine? It does not belong to me, but it belongs to the company of the shipmakers and ship traders, who are the devas of the planetary kingdom. Now I am concerned with the room as long as I am taking the journey. Tomorrow I may occupy a room in hotel the Langleteri. When I complete the journey, I take another room somewhere. So that in the next birth I may be born under Aries. So there are 4 different ways of using astrology and 4 different types of understanding the use of astrology. The first group of people who believe in astrology, they believe that there is a date prescribed for their marriage and a person is prescribed for their marriage. Some souls are destined to be their children in this life, and a particular flat in a particular house is destined for them to live. So they take the astrological books and began to search for the date of their marriage and the date of their finishing their education, the dates of their voyages, and they go to the astrologer and ask him, I am proposing my own marriage. I wish to marry a particular girl. Is it possible or not according to the planets? That is how these people believe in astrology. A young man takes his wife to the astrologer, says she is on the family way, she is carrying, and I want to know if she gives birth to a son or a daughter. The scientific answer is, wait for some months. Because even though he has some methods to know if it is son or daughter, what is it that he can do? He cannot change the sex of the would-be child. it was decided at the time of fertilization, not birth. And at the time of fertilization, some other factors decided the male or female of the change. Those factors are known as the parts of the plan of this universe. And since the planets are among the executives of this plan, they know at the time of fertilization whether it is female or male. Even then, it is not true that they know just as we want to know. They know it only as a command from a higher level. It is for them to obey the command, because the advent of a soul into the physical kingdom is something which is not accidental. A purpose is intended for every soul that comes into the physical kingdom. And the purpose decides if he were to be born as a male or a female. Some people believe that males are always born as males in their rebirths, and females are born always as females. It's not correct, because the physical difference of male and female is only a matter of convenience in nature for the purpose of reproduction and multiplying the species. Nature never intends more than that, and hence nature is concerned only with the numbers and the groups and the arrangement of souls. Just as the manager of a big house